Hello, good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 6th Annual Calgary Climate Symposium. My name is Cody Field. I'm a public program coordinator with the city's Climate and Environment Business Unit, and I'm very excited to introduce today's Climate Symposium webinar session. We would like to take this opportunity to appreciate and acknowledge that we are presenting from the ancestral and traditional territory of the Blackfoot Confederacy, made up of the Siksika, the Piikani, the Omska Piikani, the Kaina First Nations, the Yethka Nakoda Wichistabi First Nations, comprised of the Chiniki, Bearspaw, and Goodstoney First Nations, as well as the Tsutina First Nation. The City of Calgary is also homeland to the historic Northwest Métis and to the Otipemessuwa Métis Government, Métis Nation Battle River Territory, Nose Hill Métis District 5, and Elbow Métis District 6. We acknowledge all Indigenous people who have made Calgary their home. For today's session, we are using the Microsoft Teams live event platform, and the entire session is being recorded. You may access the recording with your link for 30 days, and recordings will also be posted to calgary.ca/climatesymposium in the coming weeks. As members of the audience, you will not be able to share your audio or video. However, we encourage you to interact with myself and the presenters using the Q&A by submitting a question or a comment. The Q&A button looks like two overlapping speech bubbles with a question mark on the top one. And we will try our best to answer all of your questions either in the Q&A or by asking the speakers at the end of today's presentation. We apologize in advance if we're not able to get to your question, as sometimes the Q&A can be very active, but we'll also be posting announcements, links to resources, and URLs in there as well. So thank you for joining us today for our Climate Symposium session, The Electric Micromobility Movement, E-Bikes, E-Scooters, and Urban Mobility Solutions in Calgary. Here's our agenda for today. The session will last approximately 75 minutes, which includes 10 to 15 minutes at the end for questions. I would like to invite you to join the discussion about climate change and this event on social media using the hashtag YYC Climate Symposium, as well as to register for more free learning sessions at calgary.ca/climatesymposium. And without further ado, I would like to introduce our presenters, Jordan Carrier, Steve Bentley, and Doug Clark. Originally from Canada's East Coast, Jordan developed a passion for sustainable energy solutions and led multiple residential energy efficiency finance programs throughout the Maritimes. Jordan holds a Bachelor of Science in Environmental Science and Economics from Dalhousie University, and in 2023, she joined the City of Calgary's Climate and Environment Department, currently working as a public program coordinator, connecting people to local climate programs, initiatives, and tools with a focus on electric mobility. Steve Bentley is a longtime climate activist, co-founding member of the Calgary Climate Hub, Alberta regional organizer for Climate Reality Canada, host of the Climate of Change series, as well as the Climate Lens podcast. Doug Clark has been a cyclist in Calgary since the 1970s. He enjoys all kinds of cycling and added e-bikes to his cycling options back in 2017. And having experienced the fun and utility of e-bikes, Doug has since been promoting e-bikes as much as possible. He is currently president of Bike Calgary, a volunteer-run nonprofit group working to make Calgary a human-centered city that encourages and enables active mobility where all people have equitable, viable, and safe options to ride bikes for commuting, errands, and leisure. And before we get going, I would just like to take a moment to recognize all of the partners in the community who helped to spread the word about the Climate Symposium and participated in sessions throughout this week. Our generous and supportive 2024 Climate Symposium partners include those shown here. We would also like to thank all of our speakers, MCs, hosts, and staff working behind the scenes to make this event happen. I would now like to introduce our first speaker, Jordan Carrier. Thank you so much, Jordan, for joining us today, and I now invite you to share your presentation.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Cody, for that lovely introduction. I am just sharing my screen here and going into presenting mode. So as Cody mentioned, my name is Jordan Carrier, and I am very excited to kick off this session by speaking on electric micromobility from the City of Calgary's perspective. So traffic is something that I think we all deal with, or we've all been affected by, especially if anyone's tried to utilize the Deerfoot in Calgary recently, or maybe anytime at all. But do we really consider all the repercussions of traffic beyond inconvenient delays? 39% of Calgarians live within 250 meters of a high traffic roadway, and Health Canada estimates that every year in our country, traffic-related air pollution directly contributes to negative health outcomes, including asthma, respiratory symptoms, and even in some cases, death. Transportation currently accounts for 1/3 of citywide greenhouse gas emissions, so it is really important that we focus on this sector in order to reach our climate goals. And in order to do this, the solution is rather simple, is to encourage other forms of transportation, and electric mobility is a growing option and popularity that we're seeing across our city. So what exactly is electric mobility? It's a relatively new term that is used in public discourse, and it's all about transporting people and goods using electricity as a power source. The smaller versions that have one occupant and can be used on pathways like bikes and scooters are called electric micromobility. So I do want to spend a little bit of time on this slide to go over our definitions. Starting on the far left, we have electric bikes, also known as e-bikes. These are bicycles that have an electric motor, and there's several forms available depending on the rider's need. The main variance is whether the rider would like to pedal more or have more of a electric boost, and the speed ranges can vary as well. And like your standard bicycle, they do come in many different shapes and sizes. The next one I want to highlight here are e-scooters. They're pretty straightforward, operating like a normal scooter, but there is usually a lever on the handlebars that opts in for that boost from the battery pack. And it can be foldable, standing, seated, three-wheeled, and also off-road. And then moving on to other types of electric mobility more broadly, we do have electrified commercial vehicles, which includes electrified long-haul trailers, electric buses, and other forms of transportation. And these do operate similar to electric vehicles, which we'll get into next. There are many types of different zero-emission vehicles. For the purposes of this presentation, I am focusing on electric vehicles, and there's two classifications to highlight here. One is our plug-in hybrid electric vehicles, also known as PHEVs. These can be considered zero emission depending on how the driver uses it. So for example, if you plug it in overnight and then use it on your shorter commutes, chances are it would lead to zero direct tail emissions, making it a ZEV vehicle. And then we also have our battery electric vehicles known as BEVs, which is your more standard Tesla type models where it's solely battery pack operated. What is modeshift? Modeshift's another term that I will be using throughout this presentation, and it's really shifting the preferred mode of transportation from private vehicles to high quality transit, walking, wheeling, and carpooling networks. The city did set some goals and priorities for 2075, and that includes to have 20 to 25% of trips by walking or wheeling, 15 to 20% by transit, and 55 to 65 trips by vehicles. And you can compare this to our 2022 data, where 81% of all trips in Calgary were taken by personal vehicles. I should mention too, when we talk about wheeling here, that's bikes, scooters, any type of mobility where it is a single wheeled device that can be used on our pathway system. So why are we seeing more electric mobility? The first thing I want to focus on here is our Calgary Climate Strategy Pathways to 2050. This was approved by Council in 2022, and it does include the theme of zero carbon neighborhoods, which aims, of course, to get Calgarians towards that mode shift, and also using zero emission transportation. So those other examples I explained earlier. Beyond that, though, it's proven that Calgarians do value high quality of life, which also includes natural environment and clean air. So oftentimes electric mobility options do align with those values for Calgarians. Electric mobility is becoming a new norm across Canada and globally. So people are seeing, you know, their neighbors purchase an e-bike and charging infrastructure going up across the city, and media is taking that coverage as well. And then beyond that, the industry is buying into electric mobility. So we are seeing prices decrease and the technology continues to expand. Another thing to highlight here is that the demand for goods movements has increased as well. So transportation obviously doesn't just mean transporting individuals, but also that good aspects. And with the growing scale of online delivery service, there is becoming more demand and a significant opportunity to reduce emissions and make a difference within this realm. And this includes every step of the process, so long distance fleets to last mile delivery. And industry is seeking opportunities and innovative ways to decarbonize their operations, with electric mobility often being a top choice. And that's another contribution to why we're seeing more electric mobility in Calgary. So what is the city doing? The city's doing different things to support electric micromobility. One is compiling resources to help Calgarians make informed decisions. I will go over that in more detail later, including some education campaigns that we're leading. We're building out Calgary's pathways. This means that we're continually funding to improve our pathway system, make crossings more safe, and just developing out that pathway system in general. We are offering a shared micro mobility options every year. So again, I'll speak to this later in the presentation, but you're probably familiar with those colorful e-bikes and e-scooters that people can drive across the city. And then working on more options for secured parking for our shared program. We do have around 30 designated parking areas, and then we are working to make parking more accessible for non-shared models, so for personal devices. What are benefits of electric micromobility? There's quite a few. The first one that I want to highlight is it can be a more accessible option due to that mobility aid, that power boost. So for example, e-bikes are more inclusive mobility, as they do offer that boost. So you can rely on the motor to get you up some more steep hills, and you can still connect with the outdoors, still get that activity in without overdoing it. Another advantage is that they are more affordable than your average vehicle, and it's a great option to integrate with public transit. So if you are using shorter commutes in your day-to-day lifestyle, or you want to commute to a transit station, it's definitely good to look into electric micromobility from an affordability standpoint. Another thing to highlight is that annual maintenance for electric micromobility options, so e-bikes and e-scooters, is around $30 to $50, which is usually cheaper than filling up a tank of gas. And it provides options for individuals without a driver's license too, so that's a benefit. Anyone 18 plus can use our shared micromobility program. And of course, I've been talking about this a lot through the presentation, but we are currently partnering with Neuron and Bird to deliver year-round low-cost transportation options to Calgarians. The benefit of the shared micromobility is really filling that first and last mile gap to connect with transit. It saves you time on short trips. It provides access to a lot of demographics and can improve physical health. I really do like this graphic, it highlights some ways to make sure that we are commuting safely. Safe commuting is a responsibility for everyone, and I do want to share 5 key things to think of while you do use electric micromobility in our city. The first mindset to have is that it is pedestrian first. So we ask you to always yield to pedestrians on sidewalks. The second is to be considerate. The shared micromobility devices come with a bell, and if you do not have one on your personal device, I definitely recommend you have that, and you can just alert people when you are passing. We want you to ride safely, so this includes helmets. They are not required, but they are definitely encouraged, following our maximum speed limits and making sure that there is only one person on each device. We ask people to park responsibly as well. Make sure that that's upfront and in designated parking zones for the shared program. And then 5th is there is a right to report. So if you do see any device parked improperly for the shared systems, you can contact that provider, so either Bird or Neuron. And each device does have a clear label that you can reference that number. I shared most of these rules in the previous slide, but the image on the right is super great. It highlights some nuances of where different devices can be. You will see that there is a difference between a personal e-scooter versus our shared e-scooter in terms of where you can take them. And that mostly comes down to the fact that our shared e-scooter can automatically reduce your speed and it is controlled, whereas we can't guarantee that personal e-scooters do that. Another thing in the text here on the left hand side that I didn't mention before is that the shared e-bikes and e-scooters are not sanitized after each use, so please do make sure that you sanitize your hands before and after your ride. It is a common misconception, not only on the electric side, but just cycling in general, that you need to store them away during the winter. But as a matter of fact, many riders continue to cycle and wheel throughout colder months. I'm not going to spend too much time on this slide because Doug Clark from Bike Calgary will go into a lot of detail about this, but I did want to mention that the city prioritizes cleaning cycle tracks and frequently used pathways. Riders do have options to prepare for winter, like swapping for winter tires, staying on cleared pathways, and adjusting your riding style to slow down and be cautious on turns. And that shared micromobility program is provided year-round, so you can still have access to Neuron and Bird devices. They do pull their fleets though after a weather event, just until everything's cleaned up. Some fire tips as well. So electric mobility is powered by a battery, and although it is a rare occurrence that fires do start, it is important to know the risk and know how to mitigate those risks. So first of all, we recommend only purchasing and using e-bikes and e-scooters that have reputable testing agency marks, and there's a list of them there, so UL, ULC, or CSA. Do not leave your device unattended while charging. Make sure you follow your manufacturer's guide on how to safely remove and charge your battery. Conduct regular inspections, especially after collision, to make sure your battery is not damaged. And then this is what we recommend for all Calgarians, regardless of their preferred transportation method, but make sure to check that your fire alarms are working properly on a regular basis. And finally, this is me wrapping up just the last 2 slides here on what we're doing to support other forms of electric mobility. I did allude to previously on the education piece. We do have community engagement sessions, including educational pop-ups for EVs and electric micromobility. This presentation is part of that as well. And we do have opportunities for test drives of new technologies. So Steve from Calgary Climate Hub will be presenting on an event that we hosted this summer. And then we do have one coming up this weekend, actually, at Pixel Park, if you're interested in testing out new EVs. So it will be an EV roadshow this weekend. Beyond that, Calgary Transit also has some carbon reduction goals for their fleet, and that includes procuring battery electric buses, participating in a fuel cell electric bus pilot, and exploring the feasibility of hydrogen. Calgary Transit does want to note that They will only purchase alternative fuel buses once proven performance in our climate is shown. And then that could be a combination of different things. So they might use electric buses for shorter trips and then hydrogen or other low carbon fuel buses for longer trips, depending on what studies show. And then my last slide here is highlighting that by 2030, there is a goal for all newly registered vehicles for hire to be zero emissions. And we are exploring how to support that. What we mean by this is Ubers, taxis, things like that. And then delivery and good movements, we are working with partners like Alberta Eco Trust to support innovative initiatives for delivery and movement of good. I would like to thank you for listening to my presentation today, and I encourage you to stay up to date by visiting calgary.ca/electricmobility. There is a newsletter that you can sign up for that will keep you updated on all events that are going to be coming up, as well as announcements on new programs that we will be launching. And with that, I will stop sharing my screen. And our next presenter is Steve Bentley from Calgary Climate Hub. So Steve, if you want to unmute yourself, and we'll get your slides up here soon. There we go.
Thank you very much, Jordan. And thank you to Cody and the rest of the team there, and certainly the mayor for having this climate symposium. I think it's an important thing. I'm really glad to be a part of it. Quick introduction about myself. Climate activist since 2006, a co-founding member of the Calgary Climate Hub in early 2017, and I also connect with climate hubs across Alberta and the country through an organization called Climate Reality Project Canada. And I've included a quote from Joan Baez there because it's something that I live, and I really want to, whenever I get a chance, I like to communicate to people that if climate is something that upsets you, it causes you stress and grief, which is a very normal thing, action is the antidote to despair. I've lived it. The Calgary Climate Hub has enabled me to work on climate. And by virtue of sitting around a table with really smart people and working on the problem and getting solutions through at the community and the municipal level, as we do with the Calgary Climate Hub, that's the thing that takes away some of that despair and actually starts to make you feel good and hopeful about this stuff. So consider going to calgaryclimatehub.ca and joining. If you like, we like to say, if you've got time, donate your time. If you've got money, donate some money. If you've got expertise, we can always use that too. So consider joining with the Calgary Climate Hub. And then just a few more items there. I used to do some climate events across the city of Calgary in an event series called the Community Climate Conversations. COVID hit and I was out of a job, but I was very fortunate to be asked to host a series of webcasts or Zoomcasts, interviewing climate leaders across around the world. And we were able to do that, and it was very easy to actually get a hold of them because climate people at that point in time weren't really used to being listened to. But we were able to keep that conversation going, and we've got it going to this day. And then beyond that, the Climate Lens podcast. We're recording our 27th episode right now, and what happens every month is my team picks a timely topic, and we find the smartest guests we can think of for that topic, and I ask the smartest questions I can think of. And the goal is that if you spend 30 minutes with us each month, you're going to walk away up to speed. And so before we get into the electric biking thing, I just want to touch on the cycling thing and what that's been for me in my life. The definition of a cyclist, or at least one of them, is a person who rides a bicycle. And I feel like that's a pretty basic definition. And I wonder if it even applies anymore, because for me, it's not a fad or a hobby thing for me. This is, as it says here in the slide, this has become my prime mode of year-round transportation. Each week of the year, I'm absolutely on that bike at least once. And of course, the warmer weather, I'm there every day. And this is my prime mode of transportation. So again, not a fad, but it's also become the prime mode of near daily exercise, and which gets more and more important to me as I get older, which happens, it seems to be more and more these days. But and then beyond that, I also like to say that it's a consistent near daily source of pure joy and exploration. And I think anybody that gets on a bike, especially me after a lifetime of not being on a bike, once you get on that bike, you almost rediscover every day how much joy it gets you just getting on and moving around. So it's something I recommend to anybody. I'm going to just spend a little bit of time on this slide, not as much as I'd like, because it's just such a tiny piece of infrastructure that our city built. And it's such an important piece that I really could talk a lot longer on it, but I'm going to talk about it very quickly. First of all, 12th Avenue Southwest is kind of the key piece of bike infrastructure going east and west across the downtown. And it was that I noticed as I was walking around. I was literally thinking about how am I going to get a little more exercise in my life? And here's my city building me a piece of infrastructure. And I noticed that it being built. And that's what encouraged me to get a bike. And that is such a huge piece of joy that got brought to my life just by noticing this infrastructure getting built. And then the city went and did me another great favor by the Second Street extension from 12th Avenue to 26th Avenue Southwest. So that brings you right into Mission, right into to the Elbow River. And that connects the downtown core bike system with the rest of the southern Calgary bike system, and I think it's just such a critical piece of infrastructure that I could. There's a number of different ways that it's made my life better, and if I'm going to be nerdy about one section of the city's bike paths, that's my unsung hero. So beyond all that, eventually it was COVID was we had gone from doing no public events, no out there in the real world events during COVID. And then in 2021, we felt like the safest thing that we could do at that point, while we were still negotiating our way through vaccines and everything else, was to hold our first event as an outdoor cycling event. So lots of fresh air around, and we're in no enclosed spaces. And it was a really great time. We had a sort of a shifting group of people of around 20, I think, at the time. And the goal of this event was really just to expose Calgarians to the downtown bike path system, the active transportation network, as it's also known. And but on top of that, we also wanted to get a few people on e-bikes. So this is our first foray into micromobility. In fact, I don't even know if that term existed in 2021. Maybe it did, but I certainly wasn't using it. And so we were very fortunate and remain fortunate to have partnered up with Bowcycle e-bikes in the East Village. They loaned us, I think, 3 e-bikes that year. And each year since then, because this has now become an annual event, Bowcycle has very generously donated these e-bikes to us. And what I can tell you is regularly, I would say each year, somebody that tried that e-bike out for the first time has gone and purchase an e-bike. And that reinforces something that I learned later on from a friend of mine. His name is Sean Tuff of Tuff Hill e-bikes. The best advertisement for an e-bike is just to get somebody on it, because when somebody gets on it, you feel it. You feel that boost when you're driving along, and you feel that straight up joy. And then this is a picture from the next year. This is one that's on our website that we show all the time, because what a great event. And so by having a cycling event like this, we're able to, if you look through that crowd, you can see people of all different age demographics. And it's been a really great turnout. You know, we had folks with young kids. And I look in this picture right now and I see people that went on to become, climate champions in their own rights, or opened up, an e-bike store in one case. and running another cycling event. And so it's a really great time for folks to come in and spend some good time and learn a little bit, but have a lot of fun and make new friends. This is an annual event that goes on every July. Keep track of the Hub and Spokes website and socials and make sure you sign up for next year, because we're only going to keep going with this thing. Just another shot from this year's Hub and Spokes event with a number of great folks that came and joined us. And it was a really fun event. We stop at a few spots and point out what we think are some climate advantages from this area and things that we're doing that are making the world a little bit better as far as city building and placemaking goes. And we had we met a bunch of friends who are now part of this emerging coalition of bicycle and climate champions in the city. And come this particular summer, we got asked by the city and whether we could do a similar event, or actually the same kind of event as Hub and Spokes, but for micromobility. So in this case, electric bikes and electric scooters. And so it was a whole different kind of a challenge to figure out and work together, but we were able to do it and we really enjoyed it. We have a video that we have prepared for this. I'll just let you know that in approaching this event, as a guy who hosts a show and interviews people much smarter than I go through a research process before I hold the interview, and I did the same approach for this particular Hub and Spokes event. I wanted to be smarter on micromobility. So what you'll see in this video is a lot of quotes from my research that comes from magazines and articles online. All of those quotes, we're going to provide a link in what's called our micromobility fact sheet that you'll have access to, so you can find out where those quotes come from and learn a little bit more yourselves. Take it away with the video there, Cody.
Thank you.
So I'm not sure, there seemed to be a little bit of audio fuzziness on my end there, or what I heard, but hopefully it didn't hurt the video too much. I guess the other thing I just want to say on the next slide there, Cody, is just that in my research, it's in the other direction actually. In my research for this event, and of course from event day, going into the event actually, I really feel like micromobility became one of my favorite climate solutions. And so that'll be just, I think, one slide up there, Cody. And the reason, maybe in the other direction. One more. There we go. And the reason is, it's quite a lot of climate solutions aren't just a win, they're a win-win. So by that I mean, it's good for the climate, but it's also good for a number of other things. And micromobility is a perfect example. Healthy, it's a lot of fun, and it is kind of gaining ground all on its own, which I think is really impressive. Next slide, please. The next slide, just very quickly, wear helmets, save life. That's pretty basic. You shouldn't be doubling. It's a good way to end up. I have no doubt it's fun on a date, but it's not so fun if you end up in the hospital. This is just common sense stuff. It makes perfect sense. But that's something I would advise to you. And the big question I have for you is just, how do we get this particular solution into the hands of the people that need the most, especially those groups traditionally left behind by society? Too many times, a lot of the solutions on climate are only available to those that live in rich neighborhoods or have lots of money. We want to find a way to make it so that everybody has access to this incredible solution. I just want to let everybody know about an event that's happening this Saturday. So my micromobility presentation is over, but we have a number of advocacy campaigns that the Calgary Climate Hub will be kicking off this year. We were successful in achieving a number of our goals last year. If you want to jump on to some climate action, you don't know where to start, this is the place. Check out calgaryclimatehub.ca. There is an event, as I say, it's on Saturday, Memorial Park Library, 2:00. You can get in at the ground level and help make some real change. And those are just some of the hub sponsors. We're really grateful for helping us out. Like I say, if you have the ability to donate, we'd be very grateful. It's a tough dollar here in Calgary sometimes. Every little bit helps. And finally, this is for all of you who are watching here today. If you want to get out there and try an electric bike for yourself, the Bowcycle e-bikes are incredible sponsors, have been really, really nice to give us this 30% off rental discount for you. So you'll have to show them this image or the code climatehub2430, screenshot that right now, or you can access this on our fact sheet. But this is a good chance for you to take what you're learning today and you're curious about it, you want to check it out, go down to Bowcycle e-bikes. Tell them the Calgary Climate Hub sent you. They'll give you 30% off. And that's my presentation. Thanks again to the city and to the mayor for holding this climate symposium, and to Cody and Jordan and the team there. It's really great to have some partners willing to work on climate in Calgary. Let's get this thing done, folks. And from there, I think we're turning it over to Gary from Bike Calgary. Gary, do we have you online there? Or sorry, not Gary, it's Doug. My fault. Doug, Doug is from Bike Calgary, and he's going to talk a little bit about winter biking. Really, the premier bike organization in Calgary. That's Bike Calgary.
Thanks, Peter. I mean, Steve. Sorry about that. All good. I will just share my slides here. Hopefully everybody can see that. Again, thank you. Thank you, Steve and Jordan, for setting up the stage. A great overview of micromobility, e-micromobility, and and intersection with climate and just improving our city in general. And of course, Steve, enjoy your comments about the joy that you've derived from that. And again, thank you to the City of Calgary for hosting this event. It's a great opportunity to learn more about what's happening on the climate front and what we can do individually to move the needle. As was mentioned in the introduction, I'm Doug Clark with Bike Calgary, and we're looking to see if we can make cycling as appealing and safe and comfortable for as many people as possible in the city. And of course, now with winter approaching, or well, I guess we had snow last weekend, so it's now maybe here, a great opportunity to talk about e-biking in the winter in Calgary. And I've been doing it for a number of years and thoroughly enjoying it. Just maybe point out, this picture was my regular morning commute into downtown, and the e-biking allows you to get around your city almost effortlessly year-round, and gives you the chance to just stop on a bridge and enjoy this beautiful city that we live in. So with that, why don't I jump into the outline of my talk. Expand a little bit more about why biking is so appealing and the solutions it provides. Talk specifically about the pros and cons of e-biking in the winter. Things to think about as you explore the options of different e-bikes out there and how you might set it up for safety and comfort in the winter. What to wear. Obviously, that's a question that comes up all the time. For winter biking. Some of the things you might encounter in terms of the actual riding conditions and how that might impact your choice of how you get around your neighborhood in the city, what routes you select. And then the other thing is obviously some characteristics, how do e-bikes actually handle in the winter in comparison to a regular bike or other things you might be used to using in the winter. And then finally, just pause on some useful resources for additional information. And of course, I think we'll have a Q&A after this, so additional chance to speak about maybe more details. The next thing I wanted to just mention was, of course, when you talk about why do I want to bike in the first place, it's really around the sustainability of this transportation option. There are many reasons why people might not have a car as a way to get around the city, maybe by choice, or maybe you don't have a driver's license, maybe you're too young, maybe you can't afford a car. So this really is an important option to get around the city in a sustainable mode. It is lower cost than many other forms, and it provides a health benefit, both physically and mentally, a great stress reliever. Helps reduce traffic congestion as well. You know, bikes getting off the road, cars getting off the road with people taking a trip on a bike, on a pathway or protected bike lanes, does overall help reduce. It is a piece of the solution in reducing traffic congestion. The other thing, just before I leave this slide, I'd like you to think about what it is that may be preventing you from riding more often in the city. Maybe just think about the top two things preventing you from biking more. And if I don't maybe address some of those concerns in this presentation, then please bring them up in the Q&A and we can talk about them. So basically some of the pros of winter e-biking, they're quite numerous. Some that I just want to highlight is that extra power that you get, the power assist, the boost that you get. It'll get you through rougher, you know, winter pathway and road conditions. It'll get you up those hills. And so that is a really important part of this. And of course, it gets you around the city without having to exert yourself as much. You know, a lot of people worry about, well, I'm going to get all get to work or get to the place I'm going all sweaty. And well, this is a way to get around that. And we'll talk more about that in the what to wear section. The other thing, of course, is where was I going to go with that? Oh, yeah, the other thing I just point out is that improved traction. The bikes are generally a little bit heavier. You can afford to have a bigger tire on that. And so it does generally give you better traction, potentially in the winter, if you go to those larger tires. There are some cons, of course, that come along with e-bikes. They generally do have a higher cost than a normal bike. And with that, you might have more concern about theft. You may be a little reluctant to take it out in places that might be a little riskier from a theft standpoint. And it's also just generally a heavier bike. It's got the motor, it's got the battery. And so for those that are maybe not as capable, maybe you're elderly, it is a little harder to sort of maneuver around. Maybe if you're in an apartment, you would take a normal bike up the stairs to keep it in your apartment. Well, an e-bike is a little bit harder to maneuver in that sense. It is heavier. And then, of course, there's the battery component of it. And as Jordan pointed out, you want to look for certified batteries that are safe. And there's a few other things that we'll talk about in terms of battery care, especially for winter. So a few things that are kind of additional and things that you need to be aware of. Talking about what kind of a bike might be good for you, there are many factors that go into that decision. And it really is a personal kind of decision. What kind of budget are you working with? Are you able to look at a new bike, or are you limiting yourself to used bikes or shared mobility, like Jordan pointed out with the two outfits that offer shared e-bikes and e-scooters in the city? Or would you consider a retrofit? There are kits available that allow you to add e-assist to a regular bike, and that may be a cheaper way to do it. The other thing, of course, is parking. Where am I going to park the bike? Is it safe? Is it easy to use? Is it does it require lifting the bike, upstairs and things like that? And then, of course, the other thing is the quality of the bike. And again, Jordan alluded to that. You want to get a bike that uses a high quality battery and charging system. Those generally have some sort of certification UL sticker on them, so look for that. If you're buying a bike from a reputable dealer, bike store in the city, generally you won't have to worry about that sort of thing. That they would sell and service and stand by the bikes that they offer. So that's really all I wanted to share from this slide. The other thing, of course, is, again, as Jordan hinted at, bikes come in many shapes and sizes, and it's especially true for e-bikes, because with that extra motor assist, you can go to potentially larger or at least have greater cargo capacity with the bike. So e-cargo bikes are becoming quite popular. It allows hauling cargo, hauling kids, pets, groceries, you name it, and it really opens up a whole new world of micromobility and what a bike can do. Most of these bikes will be fine for winter conditions, and we'll get to that in the next slide. One I'll just point out, and that is in the upper left here, does have a larger tire size, sort of a fat bike tire size. So those generally are the most stable in the winter. Although if you want the ultimate instability, this three-wheel cargo bike in the bottom left would give you that, because three points of contact with the road, you're not going to tip over. You might slide around a bit, but that actually may make it more fun, and I speak from firsthand experience on that. Other bikes appear quite normal, like this bottom left one, but even that, there is optimization in designing it for winter in Calgary. This one has a belt drive, it's got the built-in fenders, you know, there's lower maintenance and potentially a much nicer bike to use in the winter situation. Yeah, I think I'll leave it there and just go on to some specific things that you might want to look at. Really, you know, in the winter, obviously there are more hours of darkness, so lights become critical, and having a nice, reliable front white headlight and a rear red light are key for those dark conditions. And especially if you get on the pathways where we don't necessarily have lighting, then that is, you know, just like in a car, you would be using that headlight to show your the route ahead. The other thing, of course, as I mentioned, fenders keeps the bike clean, keeps yourself clean, and are a critical component to the bike. And then obviously you want to look at winter tires, something that has a more aggressive knob lug arrangement, or in the extreme you can look at studded tires and winter specific tires that have a softer rubber. The compound is and tread pattern is optimized for winter and snow. And of course, if you find yourself in icy conditions, then the studs are a real must-have, and it makes a really big difference, maximizing that stable footprint in the snow and on ice. Some other things you need to consider for the e-bike in the winter: the effect of corrosion. Quite often, you know, on pathways and on the roads, there'll be some salt put down to manage ice. So the importance of cleaning the bike and making sure things are well lubricated. Depending on how comfortable you feel, either doing this yourself or, you know, take advantage of the local bike shop to help you with that that cleaning and maintenance. Specific to e-bikes, of course, is the battery care, and very importantly, these lithium-ion batteries, they don't want to be charged if they're too cold. So the best practice is to take the battery off the bike, bring it inside, and charge it at room temperature. The other thing, of course, is expect reduced range when it's really cold out. Lithium-ion batteries do reduce the range that you get, but it won't be more than about 50%. So most bikes are, you know, giving you 70, 80, 100 kilometers of range. So if it's reduced to, you know, maybe 40 or 50 kilometers, that's still plenty of range for what most people do in the city on a given day. And just don't leave it outside on your bike if it's going to be cold out. Batteries are much happier when they're kept warm. Having said that, don't be afraid to ride the bike when it's really cold out. I've done it at minus 30, and these e-bikes, they perform really well. So don't let that be a deterrent. On to what to wear. Really, just highlight a few things from this list. You know, it's really about dressing what you feel comfortable with in the winter, and most people have different levels of cold tolerances. So it really, you know, experiment and decide what works for you. Try and wear bright clothing, you know, wear that bright scarf if you have one, you know, try and maximize your visibility. Dress for the flexibility offered by e-bikes. And like I said, we don't want to end up at our destination all sweaty, but e-bikes allow you to go a lot further without generating that sweat. So really focus on, you know, dressing what makes you comfortable. Of course, the other thing to consider in the winter, especially when you're moving through the air on an e-bike, is the wind chill. So pay particular attention to keeping your skin covered up, especially as the temperatures drop colder and colder. The other thing I'll just point out is temperatures do vary quite a bit over the day in Calgary, and you know, expect that it might be minus 10 when you head out in the morning, it might be plus 10 when you return in the afternoon, and just make sure you got flexibility for that. And of course, e-bikes allow additional cargo to be carried. So, you know, by all means, pack a variety of clothing that you can bring with you to be flexible. And then just talking a little bit about winter conditions and the routes that you might choose. There are some good maps that the city puts out, and of course apps out there that will help you find routes through your communities and across the city. Pay particular attention to which routes get snow clearing. So there's a city website that's linked at the end of this presentation that gives you all of the pathways that are cleared in the winter. So pay particular attention to that. Generally, if you're choosing infrastructure that's on the road, if it's a bike lane on the road, that will get cleared as part of the regular road clearing, hopefully. The other thing is just, you know, make sure you prioritize safety. It's, winter does present additional challenges. It's not just the cold itself, but obviously the condition of the road. And so there may be times where you're just not comfortable riding. Maybe a blizzard is blown in and you're not able to return home, or you don't want to venture out in the first place. So just have a plan B. You know, what is the option? Is it carpooling? Is it taking public transit? Is it skipping that trip for the day and rescheduling for another time? Or if you do have a breakdown, and you need some mechanical help out on a pathway or something somewhere, is there a friend you can phone? Are you a member of AMA? They offer some assistance, although I don't think they'd come and get you on a pathway. I think that would be more on a road. But anyway, just look into what a plan B might be, because winter can certainly throw a curveball if you're not prepared. The other thing is, just being aware of how the road conditions and your choice of route can change over the winter. And I just wanted to quickly go through an example of the various types of infrastructure, from multi-use pathways to separated bike lanes to painted bike lanes to shared roads in a residential community to sort of a normal feeder road that you'd see, and how that changes over the winter. And really, practice riding will teach you what your comfort level is in these various situations. And of course, your winter routes may be different from a summer route, because just again, the change in winter conditions. So I'll just advance. This will show the same location, but as different parts of winter appear. So this is the first snowfall. Obviously, the pathway hasn't been cleared and other things haven't been cleared yet, so just be careful. But actually, this isn't too bad for riding in. You've got a nice stable base. The other thing is, as we progress through the winter, things change. The snow gets churned up on the road. But by and large, the dedicated infrastructure, like the protected bike lanes and pathways, are maintained pretty well. And that's, in many cases, your best solution. Keep in mind, with an e-bike, a motor and fat winter tires really makes almost anything rideable. So there is a consideration to that. If you do find yourself in a situation where you can't get those nice cleared paths, then yeah, look for those fat studded tires and that e-bike combination, and you'll be good to ride almost anywhere. A few other recommendations. Just be careful when you're on a road. Don't drift over into that snow-covered shoulder, sort of in between the driving lanes and where cars park. There's all sorts of mess in there that you don't want to get into. The e-bike, of course, benefits. It'll help you plow through some of the deeper snow and up hills. And just remember that 311 is a way that the city can help you in terms of if you run into situations where things that should be cleared in the winter aren't, or there's some other problem with your route, please report it to 311, and hopefully that will get taken care of as soon as possible. And then finally, a few words on winter e-bike handling. Really, the key is don't do any abrupt moves. Think gentle starts and stops, gentle in the turns, slow down as you encounter more ice or you see ice and some more risky conditions up ahead. Just get that speed down. Remember, you can always lower your tire pressure for additional traction. And watch that power assist level with the e-bike. It can be tempting to just put it on full blast and you think you're good to go, but that'll really, you know, cause the back wheel to spin out and you may lose control. Go for a gentler power assist to start with until you kind of get a feel for the conditions and your bike is behaving. So with that, I'll just wrap up with a few useful links. There will be, I think, a few put in the chat or in the Q&A somewhere highlighting the Calgary bikeway and pathway maps, and that has a special link to it that shows you which pathways are cleared in the snow. And I'll also just point out that e-bikes tips for snow and ice, the last link there, that gives some really good videos on what to think about when you're controlling your e-bike in snowy and icy conditions. And with that, thank you. I'll pass that back to Cody, I think, or Jordan.
Awesome. Thank you so much. There we go. Okay. Okay, yeah. Thank you so much, Doug and Steve, for those great presentations. We will now enter our question period. I believe we have around 10 minutes to answer questions. So what I'll do is I'll just go through some that were posted in the Q&A section here, read them out and start answering. There was one comment Steve made when you were presenting, just indicating that somebody else also dropped a vehicle for an e-bike and it saved them over $10,000 a year. So that's a great comment. Thank you. Another question here is just saying that the Calgary goals for 2075 seem unambitious. And seeing if there are any other more ambitious targets. And I do want to address that targets for the mode shift that they're referring to. And there is still significantly high vehicle trips in those targets, but that would be the ZEV, so zero emission vehicles. So we still are targeting net zero by 2050 and all our programs are aligning to that. I do encourage you to check out the Calgary Climate Strategy Pathways 2050, where you can find more information. But again, that wasn't assuming that all vehicles would be your standard internal combustion engine vehicles. There is a question here too, or I guess it's not a question, but just a comment about bike spaces and parking downtown. So the city continues to work to plan out bike parking and have safe storage options for Calgarians to use. Most of these questions do seem to be targeted towards the city. If Doug and Steve have anything to add, please feel free to unmute. There's another question here, though, saying that a lot of our programming seems and discussions seem to be focusing on the core of the city. And there's questions to address bike paths outside of the core as well. And to that, I will say that we do have a pathway and bikeway team that works hard at making sure that all the city is connected via pathways. And this is continuous work, continuous funding. So there is plans and people involved in that work. And I see Steve has his hand up here.
Yeah, I think it's a very valid point that person is asking. We do have to work on making sure the other areas of the city have access to the bike paths and have that infrastructure in their neighborhoods. I know I have a good friend that I met this summer. His name is Roz. He lives in the Northeast and he is very passionate about e-bikes and bringing that to the Northeast because it is an area that doesn't have as much as the rest of the city, I don't think. And so I think that fits into a larger, more conversation about climate justice, ensuring that all neighborhoods have the same ability to participate in this new mode shift that we're going into. I think it's a smart question, and I'm glad it was asked.
Yeah, we do have a team that's addressing that interconnection. And then there is a link here to our bikeway and pathway map too, so you can see how it is all connected into the core. I'm curious if presenters today could comment on how you address the use of personal e-scooters in the city. It's technically not legal, this person was saying, due to an act, the Traffic Safety Act. Are you still encouraging? So from the city's perspective, we do allow personal e-scooters on pathways. That's that slide that I showed. So you are able to use e-scooters on pathways. Not sure if Doug and Steve have any comments to that. That's a pretty specific question. I'll jump to one. There's a lot of questions here. We're going to try to get to all of them. There's one specifically for Steve, I believe, or it says Steve mentioned accessibility for people living with disabilities. Has there been connections with agencies' uptake on people joining using e-biking in Calgary with mobility challenges? So yeah, the city does have partners, and we work towards making sure that transportation is accessible, especially when we connect it into transit, our transit systems. When we mean accessible for the e-bikes, it is that power assist, so it is less strenuous than using a standard bicycle. Are helmets required for shared e-bikes? Will the free 15-minute usage be expanded beyond? Oh, yeah. So helmets are highly recommended. They are not a requirement, though. And then I'm seeing the 15-minute usage. I'm not too sure if anything will be expanded on to that. There's a comment here about a question about being able to control the speeds for our shared e-bike and e-scooters, and if we could do that for standard vehicles as well. Unfortunately, we do not have that technology to control speeds on personal vehicles. The shared e-bikes and e-scooters are procured by the city, so we do have more regulation and policies that we can place on those technologies. I think we'll just do one more. I'm kind of bouncing around, so I want to make sure that I'm getting most of them.
While you're doing that, Jordan, could I just jump in? The question about expanding pathways beyond the core of the center of the city?
Sure.
If you go to the City of Calgary's website and search on Calgary's Pathway and Bikeway Network Program, they do have some maps that they're starting to put out there that shows how they're expanding things into the Northeast and other parts of the city, some missing connections. So that'll give you a flavor for what's happening there.
Exactly, yeah. Thanks for providing those specifics too, Doug. Okay, this will be the last question I'm seeing here, but it's just commenting on if we're looking at other types of initiatives that can make it more safer, and referring to in Europe, for example, sometimes they make their roads more narrow. I do want to say that we invest in secured bike lanes, so that would be with barriers so that cars have to stay to one side. So we are navigating different pathways and different bike systems that are safer for commuters that who use bikes and scooters. And with that, I believe that we can wrap it up here. We just have a couple minutes left, and I believe Cody has some concluding comments to make for this session.
Yeah, thank you so much, Jordan, and thanks again to all of our speakers for sharing your valuable knowledge and expertise with us today. And thank you all for your valuable questions. So just to wrap up, be sure to visit calgary.ca/climatesymposium to register for other free sessions or to view the recordings of previous sessions. There is one more happening tomorrow. And yeah, thank you all for joining us today. If you want to learn more about actions that you can take to help limit climate change and to prepare for a changing climate, please visit calgary.ca/climateprogram. We will be sending out a short survey. There should be a link to that in the Q&A now as well. So please take a moment to fill in that short survey. And we would appreciate your feedback about this session and suggestions for future events as well. Thanks again. Take care and enjoy the rest of the Calgary Climate Symposium. Bye for now.